right. If y'all are mentally here today, would you please raise your hand? Hold it up long enough I can see who's not. Thank you so much. If you didn't, did you bring your Bible with you? Hold it up. Let me see if you got it. Okay, that's great. That's great. See, some of you don't have your Bible. If you want to, you can look in the pew right in front of you, and there's a copy of the ESV, an English Standard Translation, I'll be preaching from right in front of you. And you won't have to turn to Psalm 32:89. You can just turn to page number 572 in the book, and you'll find out you're at Psalm 32, verses 8 and 9. So here lately, I've been preaching a series of messages from what book of the Bible? 1 Corinthians. So we're going to continue on that path of studying 1 Corinthians today. So where would you think I'd have you turn your Bible to? No, we're going to turn to Psalm chapter 32, verses 8 and 9, because Psalm chapter 32 has everything in the world to do with chapters 8, 9, and 10 of the book of 1 Corinthians. We're going to look in there. We're going to learn a lot. We're going to find out that the Holy Spirit calibrates the believer's consciousness by watching it with the Word of God. And you have probably, through the years, heard me say a saying. You've probably heard this 1,000 times. People do what they do because why? They believe what they believe. One of those sayings I've been brainwashing you with for forever. People do what they do because they believe what it is that they believe. That's going to come out in the message this morning. You're going to see how the conscience and everybody... By the way, how many of you think you have a conscience in here? If you are unconscious now, would you please stand up and pray? God knew nobody would because they were unconscious. But when our conscience is working like it's supposed to, the Holy Spirit filters that conscience, causes us to speak and to talk and to do things that we should. Now, people do what they do because they believe what they believe, and this is because our consciences have an influence over our lives, our thinking and the way we process things that happen in our lives. Now, your conscience will either lead you to be at peace with God, or your conscience will become calloused and drive you away from God, and you will lose the moral barometer that you have to make decisions in your life. Now, I started kind of tweeting again this week, and I shot two tweets out. Now, I want to go ahead and share with you. The first one was this: God's gift to every person is their conscience. Now, how many of you in here today consider yourself to be a person? Okay. That means that when you were knitted together in your mother's womb, God went ahead and put a conscience inside of you. In your DNA, in your making, there's a conscience. It's what separates you from you and the animal kingdom and all that is out there, because you have a conscience, and what you do has a bearing on how you emotionally feel and how you emotionally handle, deal, and process with the things that happen around you. Now, the second tweet that I tweeted out this week was directly related to that tweet, and this is what it said. God's gift to His children. Now remember, the first tweet was God's gift to people, but this one is God's gift to His children is the Holy Spirit who calibrates their conscience. Right. Without the Holy Spirit to calibrate our conscience, we still have a conscience, but our conscience could be wrong, and we are morally obligated to follow our conscience. We can lead us into some deep troubles in life. Now, before we can study chapters 8, 9, and 10 of 1 Corinthians, we need to understand the human conscience. So that's why I'm going to talk to you today about your conscience. Now, my goal is not to manipulate your conscience, but my goal today is to show you what the Bible teaches and what is absolute truth when it comes to the Word of God about our consciences, and then that will affect the way that you process information from now on. I want us to turn to an Old Testament passage, which is going to be Psalm chapter 32, verses 8 and 9. Now, I do want to say right up front, in the Greek language, and I'm not going to pull out the words and try to mispronounce them and all that kind of stuff in front of you because I'm not smart enough to do that. But there is a word that is a direct relationship between the word conscience and the Greek word itself. And you can, every time you see that Greek word, you know that it's talking about the conscience. However, in the Hebrew language, there is no word in the Hebrew language that talks about the conscience. Now, part of the reason for that is the Hebrews saw the body as one whole being, where the Greek people saw the body as body, soul, mind, spirit, and the different parts like that. So that does not mean that the conscience did not exist in the Old Testament. It just meant that there was no word to describe that. Hence is why I want to take you to show you what the conscience does. And we'll see that in Psalm 32, verses 8 and 9. So since we're there, let's go ahead and read that verse of Scripture in Psalm chapter 32, verses 8 and 9. Now, David is writing on behalf of God. David is talking along, and then all of a sudden, in the middle of what he's writing, David stops talking, and God starts talking through him. So the I that you see here is not David talking about himself. David is saying I, and when he says I, he is speaking on God's behalf, so the I is God. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. And all God's people said. In other words, if you got a horse or donkey or mule or whatever and you want it to go left or right and those kinds of things, you're going to have to put a bit in the mouth to get it to do what it's supposed to do. God's Holy Spirit takes our conscience, works on our conscience, and then our conscience is able to steer us in the direction that we're supposed to go. Now, you'll hear people say from time to time, your conscience is the Holy Spirit. Well, there is a Hebrew word for that teaching, and it's called baloney. Because your conscience can tell you something that is contrary to what the Holy Spirit would tell you. And we're going to get into why it can do that in just a little while. But right now, I want us to understand that we cannot get the rest of the messages in 8, 9, and 10 if we don't understand the conscience. And I think that's why there's so much controversy between this church and that as to whether, here's some things that are controversial, okay? Is it okay for a Christian to ever have a drink in their life? Is it okay for some Christians to play cards and other Christians not to play cards? Is it okay to practice birth control while some people don't practice birth control? Is it okay to eat meat sacrificed to idols? Okay, well, we really don't run into that one a whole lot in South Mississippi, but there's all kinds of, in fact, sometimes we wonder, are we supposed to boycott all the things that we're supposed to boycott? I don't know about you, but with shopping for Christmas this year, I forgot who it was, the stores that I'm boycotting and all the boycotts going on. So I don't have a little list so I can go back and find out which ones we're going to boycott and all this kind of stuff. But God knows that, and God, this conscience we're going to talk about has everything in the world to do with you not having to remember this thing or that thing, but you just doing what the Holy Spirit is telling you to do. So, once you get that, you can understand that. It makes all the difference in the world, and you can understand why people feel the way that they do about the things that they do, and why they ultimately do what they do, because this is what their conscience has led them to do. Now, I want to start off with some facts about conscience, but the first place that we have to start with the conscience is we got to know what we're talking about when we say the conscience. So I came up with a definition for you this week, and this is the definition we're going to use so that we can understand this. The conscience is a person's self-awareness. Now, remember, human beings have self-awareness where other animals and creatures and things of God, they're in a pack, they just exist, and they don't think about what's going to happen 4 years from now and understand their situation given in this set of circumstances. All they understand is the here and now. You have a conscience, so in your conscience, you know that there will be consequences 4 years from now based on the decisions that you make today. You do know that, don't you? If you do, look your head up and down like that, so I know you got it. Okay. All right. So you have a conscience, but the conscience is a person's self-awareness and the determination of what he or she believes is right and wrong. So your conscience has come up with this set of things that decides what is right and what is wrong. As a human, you are aware of yourself, and you determine what you believe is right and what you determine is wrong. You come into this world, let me say it this way. You come into this world with a certain amount of understanding about what is good and what is bad because your conscience has been placed in you by God, so that conscience has some parameters in it. For example, when you are a small child, your conscience already tells you that you should not murder and kill somebody. because you know that's bad and that's wrong. Your conscience tells you that you should not steal something from somebody else. Your conscience teaches you that gossip is wrong. But on the other hand, conscience also works in a positive way because it teaches you that kindness and compassion are good things, and you know this inside of you, not because the Holy Spirit is in you, but because there is a conscience inside of you. And things gravitate to either good or they gravitate towards that which is evil over here, and your conscience has got that. Your conscience works by giving you a sense of what is good and a sense of what is evil. Now, what was the name of the first two people that were placed in the Garden of Eden? You remember their names? Adam and Eve. They were placed in the Garden of Eden, and God looked at them and said, "Don't you dare, not one of you, never come over here and touch this tree of the knowledge of good and evil, or I'm going to beat your snot out of you." Is that what God said? No, no. Does anybody actually remember what God said? God said, "You can eat from any of the trees in this garden, except from the tree of the knowledge of evil, good and evil, for in the day of it you shall surely..." So why did God tell them that? For their benefit, for their good. Now, did Adam and Eve have a conscience? I propose to you that they absolutely did. Because Adam and Eve knew that they were not supposed to do the evil thing, which was rebel against God. So Eve goes over. She sees the fruit that is good. She listens to the evil arguments that are placed on this side. She comes back over here and she makes a decision with her husband standing right beside her to violate their own conscience. Was there a cost to violating their conscience? Absolutely there was. Now, they did not die the day that they ate that, but death entered their body, and when their lives ran out, they were dead, because sin, when it is manifested, bringeth death, according to what James says. So everybody comes into this world with a conscience, with a certain amount of conscience. The conscience compels people to live under its control by two ways. One, it brings peace when you do something that goes along with your conscience, and it brings angst when you go against your conscience. Like if you believe you should do something and you don't do what you really think you should have done, how do you feel after you don't do what you think you should have done? You feel bad. You feel terrible. Sometimes it will drive you to total anxiety because you didn't do what it was you were supposed to do. But when you do that which you knew that you were supposed to do, no matter how things turn out, how do you feel about it? You feel good. You feel at peace, because you'll say something like this: "Well, I did everything that I was supposed to do," or "I did everything within my power. I did everything in my knowledge. I did everything I knew to do. Is not up to me." So there's peace within your conscience. You see how that thing is working? Now, I do want to say the second step. I've said this several times, but I just want to drive it home. Everyone is given a conscience. Would y'all say that with me? Everyone is given a conscience. When you were knit together in your mother's womb. Now, from time to time, I'm going to get this question from somebody who's beginning to figure the gospel out and working through it. And they're going to say, "Well, Brother Steve, suppose you were born in Africa where you've never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you live and die and don't acknowledge Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Will you die and go to hell?" And the answer to that question is, yes, you will. Now, and then they'll say, "Well, why in the world can that possibly be if they don't know God?" And then Paul actually explains that argument, because he says that the conscience gives us enough understanding to know that we should look up towards God, who is the creator of the heavens and the earth, and we are without excuse without reaching up towards Him. And then, of course, He's the one who reaches down to us and explains to us who He is. I'm going to read to you from Romans chapter 1, a little big section that comes from Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 23, because I think it illustrates that God-given conscience that every human being has. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of man." See, good and evil, the ungodliness, the unrighteousness of man, "who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth." In other words, they're telling their conscience, "There is no God, therefore I can do whatever I want to do." It goes on to say, for what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has showed it to them from His invisible attributes. Even He's holding them accountable for that which they cannot see, because it's invisible, namely His eternal power and His divine nature, having been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor Him as God or give thanks to Him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for the image resembling mortal man and the birds and the animals and the creeping things. In other words, they made these idols that they've created. God is saying, your conscience has got enough sense to know that there is a God, and you're supposed to reach out for that God, and God reaches back down to you. Now, the third thing I want us to understand today, which is a little more complicated to understand, when a person does not yield to their conscience, they are committing a sin. When a person doesn't yield to their conscience, they are committing a sin. And you say that makes no sense whatsoever. Okay, I'm going to use an illustration that R.C. Sproul used to use. Now, R.C. Sproul died just this past year. Wonderful, godly man who wrote a lot of stuff, was on TV a lot. I mean, you can see him on the internet and all these kind of things. He had this one illustration he used to help people understand this truth. And this is what he said. Suppose you're out walking outside one day, and as you're walking, you see a wallet laying on the ground. And you reach down and you pick up that wallet, and you look inside the wallet, and inside the wallet are three $100 bills. You see the three $100 bills, it catches your eye, so you do this number here where you go. And you take the $300 out of the wallet, and you lay the wallet back right down where you fit it. You put it in your wallet, and you walk off. Now, let me ask you this question. Did you just steal $300? Okay, what R.C. Sproul hadn't told everybody is, this guy's older, and he forgets a lot. And that wallet that was on the ground was his. Now, let me ask you this. Did you steal the money? But it was his money. But what was his intent when he did what he did? His intent was to steal the $300. We have sinned against our conscience. We have sinned against Almighty God when we violate our conscience to do what we know we should not do. That is the reason that James says, that's the reason that James says in James 4:17, so whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. There will be some things in our lives that are sins for us that won't be sins for other people, because we have a conscience that's telling us what we should do. The fourth thing I think we need to know about a conscience before we go on tonight with the message is everyone's conscience is different. I want you to know this so bad. I want you to say that. Would y'all read that with me? Everyone's conscience is different. That means that my conscience may say I got to do this sometimes, and your conscience got to say you do that at the same time. Every conscience is framed around God's given intuition, and it's filtered through a person's experiences. Okay, we come into this world with a certain amount of knowledge of what is good and what is evil, but life happens. Would y'all agree that life happens? Are all of our lives the same? Every single life that we've lived is totally different. So our experiences are really different. For example, when I went to Cuba this year, and thank you so much for allowing me to go teach some of the pastors down on a mission trip down in Cuba back in the month of September. It was very enlightening for me. When I got down there, I was amazed at the things that I saw, because everybody in Cuba, I always had this thought in my head that everybody in Cuba was dirt poor and things were just terrible because they were under a total communist country. Well, they didn't have big, beautiful houses. Most of them didn't. Most of them had small houses that were well built. out of brick and block, and they had nice tile floors, and they had air conditioners in them, and they had TVs, and they had cell phone telephones and all these kind of stuff. And they began to talk to us, and I found out that what happens is everybody works for the government, and the government would give them 20 CUCs, and with that 20 CUCs, they'd go by and buy their stuff. But I also noticed that not everybody had the same thing. Some people had cars, some people had motorcycles, some people had this, some people had that, some people wore these kind of clothes, some people wore those kind of clothes. And I wondered why there was kind of a difference in the class. So then they began to explain, when I started asking the questions, they explained, well, everybody works for the government. Let's say everybody's job is to work for the government, but everybody, let's say this one person's job is to be an electrician and he installs fans. So the government gives him 10 fans to install in the new building he's about to build, but he takes 5 of those fans and he keeps them for himself, and he takes the other 5, he installs them, then he goes around and he tells people, hey, I got some fans if you need one for your house. And the guy says, well, I need a fan for my house. He said, well, give me $10, I'll give you the fan. So they take what little money that they have, they barter or whatever they do, or trade stuff out to get the fan so that everybody's house got a fan in it. So you got communism here, and then on top of the communism, you got another capitalistic system that sits on top of that, so all the people's needs are taken care of. The government knows that all of this is taking place, but they kind of turn their backs to it to keep the people from revolting against the government, overthrowing the government again. But in my mind, I'm hearing the preacher tell me, now this is what I hear the preacher tell me, everybody just steals from the government and does the best they can. Now that's my capitalistic brain from the United States of America, because if we take something from the government exists because the government has taxed you so that your money is going in there. So not only we're stealing from the government, we're actually stealing from the people that we know. But in their society, the government owns everything. Even the houses that they own and all these kind of things. So they are not actually stealing the fan. They are working within the system that they know to be working in. While in my brain, it would be a sin to take that fan. For them, it is not a sin. It's a way of life that they do things. It is not stealing. Notice I did not use the word steal from the very beginning on that, because it's the economic system by which the government is set up for that to take place. So sometimes what can be a sin for me and against my conscience is not a sin for you and against your conscience. But everybody has a conscience, and that conscience is different. Now, I also want you to understand this too. This is where we get into real trouble. This is why churches split. All right? This is why churches split sometimes. You can't force another person to obey your conscience. Okay, one person says I should boycott Starbucks. Another person says I should boycott, what's the people with the red dot? Target, there we go. I never can remember the name. Okay, some people say we should start Burger King, and then some people say we should boycott Chick-fil-A. And you know, some people are boycotting Chick-fil-A. I mean, there's all kinds of boycotts and all this kind of stuff over here, and everybody wants everybody else to do what it is that they're doing. But that doesn't mean that our consciences agree with each other. And when that violates our conscience, instead of pulling us together, it drives us apart. Right? So when you start in certain things, like when you start thinking, saying whether you can dance or whether you can play cards on it, it starts driving people and people in all different kinds of directions. So let me bring you to my fifth thought about this. God is Lord over everyone's conscience. Okay, you say, well, if God is Lord over everyone's conscience, why isn't everybody else's conscience the same? Good question. Is Jesus Lord over you? Say amen if the answer is yes. Okay. If you always do what he says in every situation, ever since he's been Lord of your life, would you please say amen? But he's Lord, right? Just like that. He's Lord over the conscience. One person's conscience may go this way, and another person's conscience goes this way. What is right and what is wrong must align to what God says is right and wrong. Okay, let's say this is what God says is right and wrong. We say that our conscience says we should do this. What does that mean has to happen to our conscience? The conscience ah! has got to align with God's will. You think that comes easy? That was tough. Probably my back's probably going to hurt over that tomorrow. But I know when my conscience don't align with God's will, I want to do what my conscience says instead of doing what God's will says. But the problem is, I'm supposed to align my will with God's conscience. Okay. You say, but brother, you have just absolutely lost your ever-loving mind. No, I hadn't. Do y'all remember a guy by the name of the Apostle Paul? What was his name before it was Paul? Does anybody know where the first mention of Saul's name is in the New Testament? Stoning of Stephen. Chapter 7. And Paul stood and he held all the coats of the people who were stoning Stephen to death. So Stephen falls down on his face before Almighty God. Jesus Christ stands up in heaven at the right hand of the Father. And as everyone is stoning him, Stephen looks up at the Father and says, I see heaven and I see the Son of God standing on the right hand of them. And then what does he say? Father, don't hold this count against them, but forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. Where had he heard that before? Jesus on the cross. They stoned Stephen. Stephen goes on up into heaven. He sits down at the right hand, at the left hand of the Father now, and he's seated up there beside Jesus. And Jesus says, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of my salvation. And by the way, well done. Stephen says, well, why'd I have to die? He said, because that fellow Saul, I'm fixing to change his conscience. So Saul goes around and he's killing Christians. Just as fast as he can find a Christian, he's killing him. You know how many nights sleep Saul lost over executing Stephen and a whole bunch of other Christians? Let me ask you this question. Why didn't he lose sleep over killing the Christians? Because the Bible says he had a clear conscience. And his conscience was clear because he was convinced that he was aligned with the will of God. Was his conscience way offline? Absolutely. Did he have to obey his conscience? He did. But it has to be aligned with God. Which brings me to number 6. Every believer's conscience must be calibrated by the Word of God. It's got to be calibrated by the Word of God, because if it doesn't, we're going to think we're doing things in Jesus' name when we're not doing them in Jesus' name. We're actually doing them in our own name. A conscience can and must change. Did y'all hear that? A conscience can and must change. All right? Because it's been filtered, it's been messed up because of our environments that we have, so it has to change. Now listen, I want you to hear this next statement. If somebody is asleep next to you, look and see if the person next to you is asleep. If they are, punch them and tell them that Brother Steve just called on them to pray. All right? If everybody's listening, I want you to hear this statement right here. Salvation is God transforming the human conscience from a self-centered individual to a Christ-centered individual. Right? It's the aligning of our conscience to focus on what Christ, who is Lord, says we will focus on instead of what we think we're going to focus on. People do what they do because they believe what they believe. They go off and do all of these things because their conscience tells them that's what they're supposed to do. When the reality is, if we would line up with Jesus, we would do what we believe we should do, because what we do would be believing the name of Jesus and doing what Jesus has called us to do. Now, the more deeply you understand God's Word, the more your conscience will align with God's will. The more deeply you understand God's Word, the more your conscience will align with God's Word. I get that from verses like Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, where it says, how much more with the blood of Christ, this is Jesus changing us with His blood, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without blemish to God, listen, purifying our conscience from dead works to serving the living God. Our conscience from going in a dead direction to our conscience going in the direction that God wants us to go. So we're not doing what we do because we have to do what we do. We're doing because what we do because we believe what we do is the right thing to do, because it is the right thing that we do. So we don't have to bunch of laws and regulations to tell us what to do, because Jesus came to fulfill the law. He fulfilled the law. Now we have Christian liberty, and we are free to do whatever we do as long as we live under the law of love. All right? So now that we know that, we want to love people so much that we don't do what we do if it's going to cause them to stumble, which brings us to tonight's message, which has everything to do with meat, sacrifice to idols, and playing cards and all those other kind of things. It also says in 1 Peter 3:21, baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you not as moral, that is the removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now the Bible speaks of three different types of conscience. Paul writes these. Number one, it talks about a good conscience. So we need to know, what is a good conscience? A good conscience is a conscience that is aligned with the Word of God, or is strongly moving towards aligning with the will of God. Then the Bible talks about a weak conscience. A weak conscience is one who is not yet aligned with the will of God. Now, here's the funny thing about a weak conscience. Are y'all listening to me? Those who have a weak conscience are the ones who think that they have a strong conscience. Those who have a weak conscience are the ones that think they have a strong conscience, because they won't go to certain places and they won't do certain things. And they'll make all kinds of boast about what they will not do. And they're pulled so far towards legalism that they're not free in Christian liberty to love the people like God wants them to love. And the message is going to show you how that works tonight. Now, we don't want to have a weak conscience. We want to have a good conscience. But what you absolutely do not want to have is a defiled conscience. Sometimes the Scripture calls it a seared conscience. You know how when you sear something, if you burn your skin and you sear it, how much feeling do you have in that skin that you just burned? After it's dead, the nerves quit working and there is no feeling in that burn spot. See, that's what happens to the human conscience when you don't align it with what God has for you to line up with. After a while, your conscience will be seared, and even though you're running away from God, you can justify everything that you do. People will say this: well, my conscience is fine with what I'm doing. You know what they mean by that? Their conscience is fine with what they're doing. You know why it's fine? Because they can't feel it anymore. So they're finding a false peace and moving in the opposite direction that God wants them to move. All because they wouldn't let their conscience be aligned with the will of God. Now, what if we got halfway to aligning our conscience with the will of God, and we stopped, and we made a bunch of rules and regulations, and we just kept the rules and regulations, and we stopped exercising our conscience? If you stop exercising your body, what happens to your body? If you stop exercising your body, what happens to your body? It gets fat. It loses its strength. It loses its oomph. What if we just made rules and regulations that we had to follow, and we just said we're going to follow those rules and quit worrying about this conscience thing, because the conscience thing is too complicated? We would quit exercising the conscience would lose its strength, and we would think all we have to do is keep all of the rules and regulations, and then we'd be in a right relationship with Jesus Christ. Well, let me ask you this question. Is it possible to keep all the rules and regulations and still be lost? Because salvation is saying God is right, and we can't get saved without the conscience becoming aware that we've sinned and fall short of God's glory, and agreeing that we're going to align our conscience with the will of God. It's almost as if God said, I tell you what, I'm just going to open their hearts, take their heart out, put a new heart in there, and I'm going to etch my word on their heart, and I'm going to cause them to walk in the way that I want them to walk. Wait a minute. It's not almost like that. Didn't Jeremiah say the heart is wicked above all? Didn't Ezekiel say, I'm going to write it upon their hearts and they will follow me? Didn't the Old Testament say that he's watching over us and he's guiding us in the way that we should go, and it is our conscience that's pulling us to where we're supposed to be? It's not the rules. It's not the regulations. It's about us wanting to be lined up with the Father because of the salvation so that the Holy Spirit can help us to see what we need to see. Listen, I'll close with a couple of quick questions. Number one is your conscience leading you towards a closer walk with God? If it's not, something's wrong. The only way that your conscience can get closer to God is by daily calibrating. A daily calibration requires daily time in the Word with God. In other words, you've got to spend time in the Word with God. Now, everybody knows, since I've been here for, this has been 22 years I'm working on right here at Ridgely now, everybody knows that every December and January I tell everybody, what are they supposed to do with their Bibles the next year? Read through the Bible. And we're going to pass out this little sheet. It's going to have several different Bible readings, and you can take them home, and you can check that little bark on there every day. You read your Bible. Some of you show me from time to time you read your Bible. And I'm so proud of you when you mark your little checks and everything. But I want you to understand this. It's never been about the checks on the block. It's never been about you actually finishing the Bible in 365 days. It's always been about your conscience. Because that word that you don't read so you can check the block. You read the word so that the word will filter your conscience, so your conscience will get in line with the Word of God. And if you want to sue me for brainwashing you for 20 years, go ahead. It was worth it. Because I look at some of you and I'm so proud of where, from whence you have come to where you're going to work with Christ, because your conscience is where it needs to be. And listen, the second thing I want to say is to violate your conscience is sin, and it requires repentance. And repentance, one or two things. Either you got to tell yourself and God that you're sorry for violating your conscience, or you got to tell God that your conscience was wrong. And if it's wrong, it requires that you acknowledge to God, dear God in heaven, I thought I was doing right when I was killing all them Christians. Turns out, I wasn't. But God, who is rich in mercy, on the day when they took Paul out, they cut his head off. He closed his eyes. And he opened his eyes. And Jesus looked at him and said, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the kingdom of my salvation. And he says, but wait! There was so much more work I had to do. He says, but you don't understand. You remember all those letters that you wrote? We're sending them out across. And those people are going to learn that they got to align their conscience with the Word of God. Just like you, Paul, repented of a broken conscience and lined your conscience up with the will of God. Paul, you know how you said everything you've done with a clear conscience? It's going to happen to a whole bunch more of them. Sit down, wait, and walk. He's working on my conscience. And he's working on your conscience. He's working on that conscience because we read what Paul had to say. And somebody's watching you as you live out your life, and they're learning that you're trying to align your conscience with the will of God, and you're going to step into glory one day, and your grandkids are going to get it. You're going to be dead and gone. Maybe it's going to be a great-great-grandchild that gets it. They're going to understand what they didn't understand when they were following their conscience in the wrong direction. But a seared conscience has got to be dealt with. And the only way a seared conscience can be dealt with is with repentance. Falling before God and telling Him, I'm sorry for being a sinner. Dear God in heaven,